Thank you. It is so good again to have you join with us at the same time each week, and we are very glad to be able to come into your homes and have you join with us in our Bible studies. As we continue now on the philosophy of Martin Luther, we're going to examine a few things here and continue on with this man that is diametrically opposed as far as salvation is as what the Bible gives. The Bible is very simple. One of the greatest verses in the Bible is John 3:16, "For God loved the world and gave his only begotten Son, and whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." And we come over here now, and we find out that truly we're living in these days that Timothy and Paul had written to young Timothy. In 2 Timothy, in chapter 4, we find out in verse 2, "Preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort." It is built up with all long-suffering and doctrine. In verse 3, "For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap themselves teachers having itching ears." In other words, because of their own lust, we're going to get somebody that's going to preach, and we can go to church, and people are going to think we're wonderful people because we go to church Sunday morning. We're God-fearing and Christ-loving people. But what they're really after is, "After their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears." Other words, whatever the people want to hear, we're going to teach. And we're surely not going to teach on sin. Heaven's sakes, if we taught on gossip and lying and adultery and living together and all that kind of stuff and preach on sins now, even if we preached on the Ten Commandments, it'd wipe about all of us out. But these are your modernistic churches. The time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. Don't preach to us what the Bible says that's going to affect our lives or disagree with our follower, those that we follow. And Martin Luther is the one the Lutherans follow. Now, let me go on and say this, if we may. In the Bible, in verse 4, it says, "And they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned into fables." In other words, I don't care what the Bible says. It doesn't make any difference to me at all. I'm going to church on Sunday morning. I want the preacher to say something that's going to make me feel good. And, of course, with Martin Luther's philosophy, well, remember your baptism now, and so forth. And I might bring this out because this is very interesting. We find out that the first indoctrination of Martin Luther in his catechisms is holy baptism. And again, that's a lie, Mr. Luther. Some of you Lutherans listening, find holy baptism in the Bible for me, will you please? I mean, do you ever look in your Bible? Do you ever check to see what the Bible says, what God says in his word? Well, most of you don't, truthfully. And therefore, you have no idea what to measure what Luther says against what the Word of God says, because the Word of God really doesn't mean anything to you, you see. Well, let's go on here, and I want to go back here now. And go with me in your Bibles, if you're able to do this now, if you will here, into John chapter 16, into the Gospel of John chapter 16. Because we have the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit, which wrote the Bible, all scriptures given by the inspiration of God, and is profitable for reproof, correction, instruction into righteousness, and so forth. In John chapter 16, the Lord said this. He said in verse 13, "Howbeit when he," that's the Holy Spirit, "the Spirit of truth is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever that he shall hear, or he shall hear, he shall speak, and he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me." Now that's very interesting. In other words, the Holy Spirit will glorify Christ, not water baptism. And you find this all the way through. Now, I'd like for you also to go here in your Bibles here, if you will, to 1 Peter. Let's go back here. And we want to take that verse again that Luther just took six words out of 36. And we come over here and we find out here in Peter that in 1 Peter chapter 3, and we're going to take verse 20 now along with verse 21. Verse 20 with verse 21. We find out that when in verse 20 it says this, "Which sometimes were disobedient when once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was a-preparing, wherein eight souls were saved by water." Now the translation of the little word "by" should be translated "through," because the water never saved anybody. The water destroyed everything on the earth, every human being. So the little word here should be translated here, through the water. Well, what was it? Well, let's go back and read it again. Which sometimes were disobedient when once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was a preparing wherein few, that is, eight souls were saved by water, or through the water. The water didn't save anybody, but the water destroyed. That's why it should be translated through the water, because it was the ark that saved. And the ark is a type of the Lord Jesus Christ. So it is the ark that saved. If you go clear back to the book of Exodus here in chapter 2, you'll find out we have the ark of Moses. We have the ark of God. We have three arks, and then we have the ark of the covenant. And we find out each one had a specific person purpose in saving. And the first of all, when we had the ark of Noah, it was to save those from the wrath of God. Because God saw that the imaginations and minds of men were evil continually. The whole earth was a mess. I mean, you just had it filled with filth. And I tell you, the truth is getting that way today, isn't it? Did you ever see so many murderers? Did you ever see so many kids killing their parents? And robbers robbing an old lady of 84, 85, 90 years old? No respect for life whatsoever and that? But anyway, the Ark of Noah was... The ark was to prepare and to save Noah and the eight from the wrath of God upon an ungodly civilization. The ark of Moses was to save little old Moses from the wrath of Satan. And the ark of the covenant was to save those that were under the wrath of the law. For whosoever shall keep the whole law, in James 2:10, and yet breaketh one point, he's guilty as if he had broken all of the law. So in verse 20, it tells us that the ark, which is a type of Christ, is what saved through the water which destroyed. Now, if you come right on down, the like figure whereinto even baptism, now remember this, the ark is a type of Christ who died, was buried, and rose again. That ark, the type of Christ, that saved Noah and the eight people from the water which destroyed. The like figure whereunto even baptism, what is baptism? The death, the burial, and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ spoken of in Romans chapter 6. Then we find out here, doeth also now save us, not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, not paying for our sins. And they have in theirs, they've changed that to, in the, I believe it's the New Revised Standard that, this John D. Harper uses here, not the putting away of taking a bath, not talking about taking a bath, which is absolutely asinine in using that kind of interpretation, when we're talking about what saves and what doesn't save, and we're saved by the ark of Christ, the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the like figure of baptism, our faith in the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, doeth now also save us, not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God by the resurrection of Jesus Christ is self-explanatory. And yet we find out that John D. Harper, he takes four words out of a verse of 36 and just throws the rest of it in the waste paper can for some of you Lutherans that are listening here. Let me read this, if I may, again. Not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, but an answer of a good conscience unto God. That's what it saves us from, because if you refuse to be baptized, then you're going to have a guilty conscience, because the Holy Spirit is going to convict you, and that you need to be baptized. And if you resist that conviction, then you're going to have a guilty conscience, because you're not doing what you know that you ought to be able to do. Because evidently, you're ashamed of the gospel of Christ, and until you put that away and quit thinking about yourself, and want to follow the Lord and be identified with Him and be proud to be a Christian because you're trusting in what He did for you while you were yet a sinner. How in the world could a person do less than give Him his best and live for Him completely after all He's done for us, you see? But now I want to go on. I don't want to take the book here just to show you how the puppets of Martin Luther just follow this man. I mean, every word, this is unbelievable. Too bad they don't follow Jesus Christ, isn't it? But I want to read you about John D. Harper. He's served congregations in South Dakota and Minnesota for nearly 25 years and is currently the pastor of Our Savior's Optal Lutheran Parish, a two-point rural parish in Sacred Heart, Minnesota. Pastor Harper has completed his doctorate of ministry degree at Now Lutheran Seminary. His doctrinal work focused on the impact of baptismal theology on the daily life of God's people and in the worship practice of the church. Now, going through the book that Mr. Harper wrote, one can hardly conceive anything, but this man was just a Lutheranite. I mean, Martin Luther was this fellow's God. We begin here, and you go through here. And I went through here, and I just want to point this out to you. This is what happens when you follow a man. You know the Bible says it's better in Psalms 118:8 and 9. It says it's better to put your trust in the Lord than put confidence in a man. And it's better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in princes, those that have a high position, maybe the governor or whatever they might be. And then in Jeremiah 5:26, for among my people are found wicked men, and they lay wait, as he that setteth snares, they set a trap, they catch men. And in Jeremiah 5:31, the prophets prophesy falsely, and the priest bear rule by their means. That means all of that. I don't know if you ever read a catechism of the Roman Catholic Church, but I'll tell you what, you won't know which ends up after you read that thing. I mean, there isn't anybody that could even come close to all that jargon that is in that thing. And I'm saying that because most Roman Catholics have no idea what's in the catechism other than the small thing that they have you when you go to take catechism and so forth. And there, but other than that, reading that whole thing through, I've read it all the way through, and I'll tell you, it's a very lengthy thing to read, and I don't know how anybody could make any sense out of some of that stuff that they put in there whatsoever. It's unbelievable. But anyway, the prophets prophesy falsely, and the priests bear rule by their means, not the Bible means, their means, all these rules and regulations they got. And my people love to have it so. And what will you do in the end thereof? I'll tell you what you do in the end thereof. You're sunk. You are sunk, brother. In Jeremiah 17:5, thus saith the Lord, cursed be the man that trusteth in man, and maketh flesh his arm, whose heart departeth from the Lord. You start putting your trust in a man, unless this man can say, here's what the Lord said. But I want to go through this. I just want to point out something. I went through this book here by Mr. Harper here, Baptized, Marked for Living. And this man has baptism on the brain, same as Martin Luther. Now, let me just give you an example. In writing on this book here, and it only has, I think, what does it have here? Let me look here just for an example here. It has 56 pages, 57 pages. I went through there, and I know I missed some. I did not just go down through every word. But you'll find out he quotes Luther on page 10, page 20. And then he refers to Luther's small catechism twice on page 21, the large catechism of Luther on page 27, and then Luther again on page 39 and page 43. And then in between there, wherever you see when you get this man's book, LB Worship, he'll put you a reference in the back, and that means Luther's Book of Worship. So there he refers to Luther again on page 12, page 14, page 19, page 23, page 34, page 41, page 42, page 46, page 53, and so forth. Mr. Hopper, you are a puppet of Mr. Luther. Sad to say, but sir, if you would have been interesting, now he does use some Bible verses, and he uses one, which is very interesting here, but he begins in and he leaves out the part that's very interesting. I'd like for you to turn your Bibles here to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. In 1 Corinthians here, in chapter 1, you'll find out that Mr. Hopper in his book here, he begins with verse 17 on down. Or in verse 18, I should say, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved it is the power of God. But he left out verse 17. That's very interesting to me. You know, these fellows leave out anything that has to do, that contradicts their water baptism is going to take you to heaven. In order to propagate this, where I don't see these other verses in here that speak about salvation in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Ephesians 1:7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. So, Mr. Luther, if you're telling me, along with Mr. Harper here, that, you know, when you're baptized, that it works forgiveness of sins, then we definitely have a big contradiction, sir, because my Bible says, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. But I'd like for you to go here in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 17, because Paul, when writing over here to the Corinthians, you find out here, and we find, if we go on back, you'll see why he said what he said. Paul had baptized some, But baptism only came after they were saved. You never find anybody ever baptized to be saved. I'm sorry, Mr. Luther, but the Bible contradicts you 100%. If you come back here, you had these in the city of Corinth and the Corinthians here. Now, if you'll notice here in verse 12, well, we'll pick it up in verse 11. For it has been declared unto me of you, my brethren, by them which are of the house of Chloe, that there are contentions among you. Now this I say, that every one of you saith, I'm of Paul. I follow Paul. I'm of Apollos. I follow Apollos. I'm of Cephas. I'm of Peter. And I of Christ. So we got four different ones. But they're all picking up sides here, thinking, oh boy, you know, this is my leader. But Paul rebuked him for it. He said, in verse 13, is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Was I crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? Now, you're baptized as a Lutheran, so what? What about all these other people that we lead to Jesus Christ and they trust him as their Savior and we baptized? They're baptized in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. But I'd like for you to go on down, verse 14. I thank God that I baptized none of you, but Crispus and Gaius, and least any should say that I have baptized in my own name. Well, I'm baptized a Lutheran. Really? Hoopy-doo. So what? Where do you find anything in the Bible? 1,500 years, this man wasn't even around. You think there wasn't Christians when there wasn't a church named after Martin Luther? I mean, are we that naive? Are we that illiterate that we actually believe this? This man didn't come on the scene for 1,500 years. Did everybody else go to hell before they were baptized by Luther? Or his protégés? Or his followers? Or so forth, as we have today, 500 years later? 400 and some years later? And then he said in verse 17, I'm sorry, Mr. Hopper, you left this out. You begin in verse 18. Maybe you didn't want your readers to see this. And then Paul wrote to them, he said, for Christ sent me not to baptize. Other words, you folks have got it twisted out. You're really trusting that it's some big thing to be baptized by Paul or baptized by Peter or baptized here, I'm of Apollos, and so forth. And some of you had it right. I'm baptized here concerning Christ. But he said, for Christ sent me not to baptize. You're getting the cart before the horse. You see, you're getting baptism here on the brain, when it is Jesus Christ who died. Christ sent me not to baptize. That's not why I came. But to preach the gospel, that is the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, because nobody will you ever find in the Bible was baptized until they believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, far cry from Luther's philosophy, well, baptism washes away your sins. Baptism delivers you from death. It delivers you from the devil. Well, I'll tell you what, I don't know what was in the water. Some of these Lutherans have been baptized, but I'll tell you what, when it tells us in Revelation that the old devil was chained, he must be chained to some of them, I'll tell you, with the way they act and some of the things that they do. Not all now, because I'm not labeling everyone like that, because there are some very nice people that go to the Lutheran church. But boy, I'll tell you, there's some scoundrels that go there too, some very sneaky, sneaky people. I'm talking from firsthand experience. And things that they say and so forth, unbelievable. But it gives you eternal salvation. Do all that believe this? No, that's a lie, Mr. Luther. Paul said, Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with the wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. For the preaching of the cross, now get this now, the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved it is the power of God. Now I'm just saying this in an area where I live. I've tried to talk about Christ to many Lutherans. And I'll tell you what, they don't want to talk about Christ. They don't want to discuss it. I've been baptized. I belong to the Lutheran Church. I go here. Or I go there. What about Jesus Christ? There's no other name in Acts 4:12. There's no other name given among men whereby we must be saved. And he completely warns us by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. If you were a Christian, you think, you know what? I'm so happy that you asked me that. I'm glad that you asked me. Yes. I'm not trusting being a Lutheran to go to heaven. I'm not trusting Martin Luther's philosophy to go to heaven. I'm not trusting my baptism to go to heaven. I'm trusting in the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Then don't tell me, and I'm saying, if you believe that, why in the world are you in a church where your leader says your baptism pays for your sins? What are you doing in a church like that? You're in a church with a false leader, Well, his false philosophy contradicts the Word of God, and then you're telling me that you believe? If you do, and you could believe that Jesus Christ and Him and your baptism doesn't save you, then you need to get in a church that teaches that. You need to get in a church of like faith, because if you're going to try to witness to those that you go to the Lutheran church and you believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ for your salvation, not water baptism, well, then you're going to have to keep your mouth shut, because if you start talking to them Lutherans about that, brother, you're going to stir up hell, because they don't believe that. They believe that Christ died and was buried and rose again historically, but they're not trusting that because they're trusting Martin Luther's philosophy that water baptism forgives your sins, it delivers from death and the devil, and gives eternal salvation to all that believe. Read it on page 174 of the Small Catechism of Luther's Small Catechism. Well, I can see our time is slipping away here just a little bit fast. We no more get started and seem like it's time to stop. I might say something else concerning this. When it comes to whether it be the Missouri Synod, the Wisconsin Synod, or whatever it is, you'll find out, I want to tell you, what Martin Luther did not believe, and neither does those puppets that follow him, because they preach what Martin Luther believed, because they use his writings, and that is more important to them, truthfully, than the Bible. It comes here, let me give you three things that they don't, and then we'll not go on that. In their writings here, and I happen to have the one, the Doctrinal Position of the Missouri Synod, I've checked the one with the ELCA, and I've also checked the one with the Wisconsin Synod, they all agree to the same thing. They do not believe in the thousand-year reign of Christ. We go in our Bibles, and we go to Revelation here in chapter 20. And if you have your Bible, I surely turn over there. Luther didn't believe this should be in the Bible, the book of Revelation. But in chapter 20, we find out that when Christ comes back to the earth to establish the kingdom, he changed Satan for 1,000 years. They do not believe that at all, that there's going to be a 1,000-year millennial reign of Christ here upon the earth. But anyway, this is what the Word of God says. And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold of that dragon, the old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. And cast him into the bottomless pit, shut him up, and set a seal upon him that he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years should be fulfilled. And after that he must be loosed a little season. Until the 1,000 years should be fulfilled. Deceive the nations. So there's going to be people on here for 1,000 years, sir. Your Lutherans do not believe that because Martin Luther did not believe that, because he did not believe the things in the book of Revelation could ever be fulfilled. This is where you get false teachers. And Martin Luther was a master at deception. Because what he didn't believe, now he wants to pass that on to you, not to believe what the Bible says, you see. Now, let me read this to you here, of the Doctrinal Position of the Missouri Synod on page 19, if you go to the bottom of the last paragraph of the millennium. With the Augsburg Confession, Article 17, we reject every type of millennialism or shilliism, and that is Christ reigning for 1,000 years, the options that Christ will return visibly to this earth 1,000 years before the end of the world and establish a dominion of the church over the world, or that before the end of the world the church is to enjoy a season of special prosperity. Now I want to stop there, because you Lutherans that believe that, that is a damnable lie. All in the Old Testament, you can go to Isaiah, you can go to the prophets, all of the prophets, or I should say most all the prophets, spoke about the 1,000-year reign of Christ upon the earth. So there's probably, I would say, over half of the Bible that you Lutherans don't even believe. Martin Luther didn't, because you got to take these verses that speak about the 1,000-year reign of Christ, when the wolf will lie down with the lamb, you got to spiritualize all of that. So there's probably, and I'm just guessing at this, there's more. This is a very conservative guess. Over half the Bible, you don't even believe in the Old Testament. Did you know that? Why don't you go to your preacher and ask her, or ask him, whichever one it is, you see, and find out what in the world, where do you people come up with this? Because of the Augsburg Confession? Who in the world cares about the Augsburg Confession, Article 17? Why don't we take the book of Revelation and believe it, instead of trying to do away with it? I'm sorry, Mr. Luther, you have hundreds and thousands of people that follow your damnable philosophy, rejecting the Word of God, inserting salvation, baptismal regeneration, denying the millennial reign of Christ, sir, and you also deny the rapture. of the many Lutherans we've led to the Lord Jesus Christ, I don't recall, well, I do recall one said he had heard of it. But as far as Christ coming in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 17, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, you people don't believe that. Martin Luther didn't believe that because he didn't believe it could happen. I'm sorry, Mr. Luther. My conclusion, sir, after examining what you write, and I could speak for weeks and weeks and weeks on the other contradictions that you make to deceive your people, you are a master of deceit, sir. Well, I see our time's gone. I hope if you've never trusted Jesus Christ, not your water baptism, and all the people that disagree with you, Mr. Luther, all the people that disagree with you, all the great Bible teachers that would have nothing to do with you, sir, but you have a following. Yes, you do. Right straight into hell. The only way to heaven, if you're listening, is to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you trust Him and Him alone for your salvation. Not water baptism. It is the blood that saves. The Lord said, as Moses was lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have eternal life. So we find out that's either true or it's not, and if you believe that, Mr. Luther, you'd never tell your folks to think your water baptism is what's going to take you to heaven. Well, I thank you so much for listening. We hope you'll take time to write us. Our mailing address is the Heritage Radio Bible Class, Post Office Box 573, Walnut Grove, Minnesota, and our zip code is 56180. Our church service is on Sunday morning from 10 to 11, and Sunday evening from 6 to 7, and our youth group, wonderful youth group we have, is from 7 to 9 on every Thursday night. Well, as we say goodbye, we hope you have a wonderful week. Always